The learned medieval mind was one much absorbed with the idea of the Day of Judgment. All agreed that there would be a time when an accounting would be called. The history of Scotland tells us of such a day. On the evening of the 18th of March, 1286, King Alexander III had been returning home from a meeting with his council in Edinburgh to his new young wife, Yolande, Countess of Dreux. In stormy weather near Inverkeeling, he lost contact with his colleagues and was thrown from his horse. His body was found, neck broken, on the shores of the River Forth the next morning. His 36-year reign had been a golden age for Scotland. His death was to hurl Scotland into a decade of uncertainty, treachery, and war with its neighbour England. Out of this turmoil, one man was to rise above all others. His name was William Wallace. He was to come like a storm from the north and stand defiant at the Battle of Stirling Bridge. The death of Alexander III was the final act in a series of tragedies that had plagued this unluckiest of royal families. Margaret, his first wife, had died 11 years earlier, aged only 35. Her death was quickly followed by those of their sons, David and Alexander. The only daughter of the marriage, also called Margaret, had married King Eric II of Norway in 1281. She was also to fall foul of the family curse. She died in childbirth. Her daughter Margaret, the Maid of Norway as she became known, was the only living relative of Alexander at the time of his death. She was only 3 years old when the ancient crown of Scotland came to rest on her head.
The effect of Alexander's death and who was to be crowned the King of Scotland, there's many levels of history and how you would look at it, but the secondary level was really a point of, because of trading activities. The Scots and the Netherland countries had actually made treaties, in particular to trade Scottish wool, greyhounds and their boat building was very, very strong in demand. So with the loss of the king and the kind of fractured English state, because England was still a residue of about 8 kingdoms at that point in time, so they were still trying to consolidate where Scotland was actually in operation, if you like.
In the world of education and religion, things had been going very well. Scotland had profited greatly from what we call the new monasticism. The new orders like the Cistercians were doing very, very well in Scotland. Between 1150 and 1250, there are 11 foundations, the new preaching orders, the Dominicans and the Franciscans are establishing themselves.
Many of the English regions, if we call it that, up to that point in time, from the end of Romano-Britain, had an excellent relationship with what you would classify as the Scots nation. And I think with the death of Alexander, it was like the head of a corporate firm who had a good idea. He was gone, and now the competitors were going to start to move in.
With their queen being a three-year-old, living hundreds of miles away in the house of her father, who was himself only 16, a regency was appointed to rule Scotland on her behalf. This council of regents was made up of 6 nobles, 3 from north of the River Forth and 3 from the south. It was hoped that these guardians of Scotland could maintain the steady peace that had existed with their neighbour England for the last 100 years. The then King of England, however, had other plans. Edward I, more commonly known as Edward Longshanks, was the most cunning king to rule over England for some time. He had proven his military worth some 20 years earlier, when, during the Barron Wars, he had decisively defeated Simon de Montfort at the Battle of Evesham. History also tells us that he had a shrewd political brain as well. He was determined to add Scotland's lands to his. His plan was to marry Margaret, their new queen, to his son Edward, who at the time was only 6 years old. To this end, he made overtures to Eric II of Norway and the Pope. It was at a meeting in Salisbury in October 1289 that a tentative agreement was reached. The representatives of Norway, Scotland, and England agreed that Margaret would come to Scotland and claim her birthright. The Scots agreed that they would not let their new queen marry without English permission. In exchange, England granted the Scots certain safeguards to preserve their independence, according to their rightful boundaries, free and without subjugation. Edward, true to his cunning, carefully inserted his own reservations into the agreement, effectively undermining these safeguards. The final agreement, together with a number of other hurried promises, were sealed under the Treaty of Bergen in 1290. The 7-year-old Margaret left the Norwegian court and set sail for Scotland. The journey was made in the height of luxury for the time. Records show that there were many rich fruits, fine foods, and more than 28 pounds of gingerbread to keep the young queen happy. Yet, despite this relative comfort, she was never to set foot on Scottish soil. Margaret, the Maid of Norway, the last of the ancient House of Canmore, was to die just days from the end of her voyage. Her death plunged Scotland and the succession of its throne into chaos. There was a total of 15 claims to the throne of Scotland following the death of Margaret. Most of these claimed their lineage from David I, some from Alexander II, a few from King Donald Ban, and others cited their links to William the Lion. Even Eric II of Norway lodged a claim, quoting some strange sort of backwards inheritance through his daughter. Clearly the matter had to be resolved, and Edward I of England must have been delighted when he was invited to adjudicate over the claims. He managed to extract promises from 9 of the claimants that they would acknowledge his lordship over their land before he even looked at the overall picture.
The fact was that Edward turned up at Norham on his mission of arbitration, backed by a very large levy of all the northern counties, and insisted that the Scots swear allegiance to him as superior lord. Now, some Scots, including Wallace, of course, never swore that oath of allegiance. And this left that crucial gap between politics and reality, which was going to be so fatal.
The two strongest claims came from the House of Bruce and the House of Balliol.
John Balliol was really the apparent heir to the throne. Many referenced him being called Tomb Tabard. In Scots, the Tomb Tabard simply means that he had a coat of arms that yet had not a sign of chivalry on it. So in a sense, it was a blank coat, and that was the Tomb Tabard. There was disputes because the area where he came from was still a separate kingdom within Scotland and would still be so, the area of Galloway, till the 14th century.
In November 1292, Edward judged John Balliol to be King of Scotland. This was the vassal king that Edward expected to comply with his requests, no matter how humiliating.
A point of deterioration between the relationships and the Scots and English developed when the English who were in Scotland to actually oversee principally the elections the decisions and the elections that the Scots would make changed from overseers to an enforced police force. And I think that would be the start of a general unrest within Scotland. And Edward abused the privilege of overseer as a neutral observer by starting to dominate Scottish merchandise.
By 1292, the Scots could stand no more of this English rule. In open defiance of Edward's wishes, they reformed the old alliance with France. England was quick to react.
The French felt very threatened by the empire building of Edward and also northern expansion, but the strongest threat came from Edward. And the fact that the Scots didn't have an antagonistic relationship with English to that point in time, it could have been very strategic because of the attitude of the Scots for the French to make an alliance based on peace treaties that were possibly up to 300 years prior to that date.
Edward himself led troops north to sack the town of Berwick, while the Earl of Surrey defeated the Scottish nobles assembled at Dunbar. King Balliol made peace, and Scotland became an occupied country. The Earl of Surrey was appointed governor, and Hugh de Cressingham became its treasurer. Scottish wealth and land were once more in English hands.
The Scots, in their ruler, in the person of their ruler, John Balliol, when he was adjudged as king, accepted Edward as superior dominus. He was feudal superior. This meant that legally, when the Scots made an alliance with the French in 1294, Edward could hold that they were in revolt against him because they were his subjects. It also, I think, explains the ferocious quality of Edward's reaction. The sack of Berwick in 1296, when he went forward and took the town apart on March the 30th, 1296, killing numbers which we can't estimate, 6,000 or 7,000 is what the contemporary sources say. We've no means of checking that. Now, this was just one of the many massacres in history, which was intended to make a point and to make an example. And you've only got to follow the list forward through English history and world history to see what reaction this sort of massacre always produces. Droyder and Wexford, Glencoe, Lidice, Little Rock, Chenaman Square, you can just go on and on multiplying the list. And the lesson of history, I think, allows of no dispute at all. This was tyranny.
When Edward departed for the south in the autumn of 1296 to prepare for his campaign in Flanders, he left behind him a Scotland with all the appearances of a conquered country. If any rebellion should break out, he was confident that it would collapse within a few weeks for the want of a leader. In this, as in many other things, Edward was misguided. Already the Scottish nobles were gathering to plot and scheme. They knew that the promises extracted by force bound no one. They could be repudiated at their pleasure. It was in the spring of 1297 that the storm burst. One man more than any other was to carry the fight with him. That man was William Wallace. As with many other folk heroes of the time, who emerge as leaders later in life, little is certain about William Wallace's early life. An account of his life written by a contemporary known as Blind Harry does exist, but much of what it contains cannot be verified from historical sources. Even the year of his birth has never been satisfactorily established.
Deciding how we test the anecdotes that come through someone like Blind Harry is, I'm afraid, part of a very much wider question of how people like Blind Harry work. And when we find that something that they say doesn't work, the temptation is just to discard them wholesale and say, this was just some blind minstrel working at least a century after Wallace's death, more.